Central Coast, so let's head on back down to the park and start out in this, my latest sojourn in the scriptures, these glorious scriptures. And as I start out on that very thing, it is a Thursday morning. It is the 8th of September. It's a beautiful, beautiful early spring morning here. It is absolutely lovely. It's Thursday the 8th. It's about 6 o'clock in the morning. And I am up to James 3, just up there. As I continue to try and reconcile, if indeed I may have already done that, just this difference between law or judgment and condemnation opposed to loving thy neighbour as thyself. But it's all, for me, it's all pertaining to the state of the heart as we throw in our motives, why we're thinking things, why we're saying things, why we pray things to the Father about others, what our heart is actually saying, our heart or the heart the Holy Spirit's given us. So many questions the Holy Spirit's given us, but that heart would be absolutely perfect if it was. But anyway, we continue on, but we throw in as our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. And did the Lord Jesus Christ himself, did he judge? Did he condemn? Did he forgive unrighteous? Did he forgive unrepentant sin? And that's the thing. I last thing I want to do is condemn anyone, and I've got absolutely no desire or intent to do it. But forgive unrepentant sin? To me, it's not godly. It's not godly. It's absolutely solidifying this now in my tabernacle that it's not godly, and it's in a direct breach for me of loving thy neighbour as thyself in the golden rule. Do unto others the way you, what you want done to you. Treat others the way you want to be treated, the way you feel you ought be treated, and the way you want the Holy Spirit to treat you and to treat others, and to forgive unrepentant sin. It's not godly, because as our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, the body of Christ, the perfect unity, we all become one. Why would that one thing be different, right? And I absolutely, I want to put it down again that I'm not sitting here talking about having a hard heart or anything like that. It's not about that. It's about having that heart of gold, as they say. That's what I want. I want to have that heart of God where you just want everybody to come to repentance. And if people don't come to repentance, well, they're not going to believe. And if they don't believe, they're not going to have their sins washed away, and they're not going to have the Holy Spirit, which means they're on the wrong side of the divide, right? They're goats. They remain goats, right? They remain goats, and they're on the wrong side of the divide. That divide for me, the valley of the son of Hinnom. Now, I'm not, the run sheet today has, it's getting harder and harder, this video to put down now, because in terms of the original intent of this video, it's a bit like the last one that I did. It ended up being about 10 parts, because what I'm finding is that every day I read those scriptures, and as my testimony grows, I'm finding the run sheet, it's just gathering more and more and more, and it's just becoming bigger and bigger and bigger. And what I intended to do last video, I didn't, because last video ended up being something else, and that intent, it just keeps getting pushed back. And as I look at this run sheet now, Psalm 51, the original intent of this video, it's just getting lower and lower and lower. So to say what the intent of the video is when I set out, it is difficult, because I just had a, it is the intent to talk more about what I've just been saying about, is belief is not a choice, repentance is a choice, but for me, we need to believe to repent, but we can't repent, we can't believe unless it's by that Holy Spirit. And you don't receive that Holy Spirit, that precious gift of the Holy Spirit, unless you repent. So you need the Holy Spirit, or do you? What I'm going to do today, it is the plan, is just reflect on my testimony. I've been really thinking about my testimony as it pertains to repentance and as it pertains to receiving the Holy Spirit. And do we just make the assumption now? I don't think it's an assumption. I think we base it on testimony. But is it fair, reasonable, safe for us now to assume that the Holy Spirit, we've received the gift of the Holy Spirit, that we're becoming the new creature? I think we can safely say that now, right? So I'm going to base my testimony this morning, if I get that far, which I think I will, I'm going to base my testimony today that I give on based on that premise, right? So I'll start today in the scriptures with a couple of calendars, and this is what's happened. The calendar today in the big calendar, it was Philippians 2, which I've been wanting to read from for quite a while. And when I saw the scriptures, I thought the scripture this morning in the big calendar, I thought, I thought, I just feel really, really compelled. And I know that's going to take me a good 20 minutes or half hour. So as I say, the run sheet just keeps getting pushed back. But the big calendar yesterday, so I had the big operation yesterday, right? It's not a big operation, but I had the operation happen yesterday, and it all went perfectly. All went perfectly. In fact, it couldn't have gone better. So this was the calendar, the big calendar that I got when I set out on that very, it came from 1 John 4:20, and this is that divide that I've been talking about, and the dogs are here. Hello. Oh, you're my favorite. I like you. Yeah, this is that divide that I'm talking about once you've repented and you've been forgiven, as opposed to not, right? This is that divide that I'm talking about, and it all hinges around repentance. So 1 John 4 and verse 20, if a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, right? So this is really interesting now when I consider, Jamie, your comment on the two videos ago now, and that's the other thing I want to say, just that the last video that I just did, it just uploaded, and last I saw it was up to 4 views. So that's the state of play right now, is that it's been uploaded for about half an hour, that last video. And this is very interesting now, Jamie, what you say about Esau, right? Because Esau, the Lord hated Esau, but it was preordained. Because this is the thing as well. Rebecca asked, why am I thus? But we're not to ask that. That's pertaining to why has you made me thus? But Rebecca's asking, why am I thus? Now, when Paul says, why have we been made thus? He says in Romans 9, he says, no, you don't strive against your maker, right? It is a bit different because Rebecca she's expecting the twins, right? She's expecting Jacob and Esau. But she actually asked, why am I thus? And the answer that was given was a prophecy. The elder shall serve the younger. So it's all a prophecy. It's all preordained. But for me, in Hebrews 12, it's clear to me that Esau was condemned because he didn't seek repentance, or he didn't come forward with repentance, even though he sought it with tears. So his heart wasn't right. He made out as though, but God knows the hearts, right? God knows the hearts. And then in Malachi, we read that the God hated Esau, and Esau's the brother of Jacob. And the command was very, very clear right through that Old Testament to not hate Esau because he's your brother. There might even be a scripture to say that he's welcome into the house of God after a certain amount of generations. But here, well, the Lord hated Esau, but the command was not to. And here we're saying Esau is the brother of Jacob, who I'm being led to think is the body of Christ. Jacob for me is he's an allegory for a lifetime of a brother and sister, and as individuals and as a body of Christ as a collective, his life is an allegory for us. Jacob. So Esau's the brother of Jacob, but here in 1 John, if a man say, I love God and hateth his brother, he is a liar. So there's so much to consider, right? As I say in my last video, God's not a psycho. We know that. We know that by testimony. But when you look at this on the surface, God hated Esau because he didn't repent, because he ordained it. That's what he told Rebecca when Rebecca asked, why am I made thus? Even though in Romans 9 we're told, well, why am I thus? Even though in Romans 9 we're not to ask why we're actually made thus. The Lord hated Esau because he didn't repent, even though he ordained it before these things were. He hated him. He's the brother of Jacob. And here we're reading that God saying that if you actually love God and hate your brother, you're a liar. And God's not a liar, because God can't lie, because God's perfect. Even though we've been created imperfect in this perfect world, in this imperfect world, under the imperfect God of this world, that wretched all-seeing eye, he's made us with that heart, but yet when that heart leads us to sin, that's our fault, right? I could talk about this stuff all day. So it's very interesting now when I read that, because this for me is the center of the gospel. So what's going on in Malachi 1:3, right? If a man say, I love God and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother, whom he hath seen, how can he love God, whom he hath not seen? So this all goes to loving thy neighbor as thyself. Treat others the way you want to be treated, the way you feel you ought to be treated, and the way you want God, the Holy Spirit, to treat you, the Holy Spirit, the Father, the Holy Ghost, the blood, the word, the water, the Lord Jesus Christ, right? The Son. That's what that's starting to look like as well. So it's about the state of your heart, right? So God knew the heart of Esau, and God knows your heart, and God knows my heart, and he knows the motivations of why we're saying things and why we're thinking things, as I then reflect again on the difference between loving thy neighbour as thyself and condemnation and judgment. Because the Lord Jesus Christ, did he love everybody when he came to the earth? Did he love the Pharisees? He came to save the Pharisees, but the Pharisees chose not to repent. Even though in Isaiah 6, for me, it's saying that God, he hardened their hearts. so that the Gentiles would be grafted in Romans 11. So there's just so many levels to this, right? As I say, this scripture says this, and this scripture most certainly says that, but that's how I'm absolutely progressing that. Forgiving unrepentant sin, it ain't godly. It ain't godly, and it goes directly against this. It goes directly against this. Because we're forgiving, and as I've said this before, but I'll say it again. If the body of Christ can't execute God's laws, just like the Lord Jesus Christ did when he was on earth, and just like the apostles and the disciples did when they were on earth, how are they going to get executed? That doesn't just happen. Like the Holy Spirit, he uses the creation to get his will. Every single last time. Everything that's happened in the creation, for me, even the creation himself, even though the creation, it was created by not people in the creation, otherwise, well, not entities that were in the creation, because otherwise they'd be, how can they create what's not created yet, right? But that's the plural we see. For me, that's absolutely the plural we see. Let us make man in our own image. And that conversation between the Lord, I'm seeing that he's did it with the congregation of the mighty, that Elohim, because the Lord spoke it and the Elohim did it, right? And that's what I see. That's what I see happening today. That God's being glorified in the body of Christ, thus God's glorified in the Lord Jesus Christ, as we all become one, and the captain of our salvation is being made perfect through our sufferings, through his sufferings, as he brings many sons to glory, right? As our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. So it's about the state of your heart. Now, repentance. So this is the thing. For me, I'm going to share a screenshot in just a sec. Well, that's the plan anyway. For me, repentance, everybody has that opportunity to repent. The word of God, the water. The water comes to wash. Everybody receives the word of God. They receive the opportunity to repent. But this is the part that I can't yet reconcile, because you have to believe something in order to say what you've been doing is wrong. So what's your testimony saying? When did you actually repent? Can you actually put was it a moment in time, or was it a gradual evolution, for want of a better term, but it's the term's fine, it's how they use it. Has it been a gradual and a constant evolution? That's how it's happened for me. All of this for me, it hasn't just been instant. Like we read in the scriptures, yes, I believe. Yes, I repent in sackcloth and ashes. I do it now, because when I do things now, because I'm following the Holy Spirit, it's easy to say these things now. But back 6 years ago, when all this started for me, when did my repentance, how did I repent? How did it actually happen? For me, it was gradual. And I'll get to this in a sec. So much to say. For me, it was gradual. The moon landing hoax, that was my first sign of repentance. But that had absolutely nothing to do with confessing the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. But it led to it, right? It led to it. I had a choice. I had a choice whether to hearken to that moon landing hoax being a hoax or not. Had a choice, right? And I made that choice, and every single one of those days hence has been about me finding the truth. Truth become my anchor. Now, is that by grace? For me, it was a choice. The word of God came, I heard the word of God, and I made the choice. So now he makes that ground fertile by giving us the rain, right? And then I got this one yesterday in Psalm 103, 11 and 12. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is mercy toward them that fear him. So fearing God, for me, is believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. I've been putting that down for a while, and I'm quite content that that's the truth. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him. So believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, because we've repented. Even though this is in Psalm, but repentance is in the Old Testament. A couple of videos ago, right? They believed. They saw the signs and wonders. Thus they believed, because they repented. As far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. So that's that divide that I'm talking about. if a man say, you love God, but you hate your brother, you haven't repented, and you're not receiving this. You're not receiving those forgiveness of sins. So you're still going to be judged under the law because you're still condemned under the law. Once you repent, you're then given that, you're given that gift to believe, and then the sins are washed away, and then you're released. Then you're freed from that bondage of being condemned under the law, of serving the law, of being judged under the law, and dying under the law. We accept our sentence under the law by repenting. Yes, what's my sentence? And that's the glorious thing. That's the glorious thing. Your debt, my servant, has been paid. Now you come and serve me. Now your life really starts to begin, right? So that's that divide that I'm talking about. If you actually say you love God and you still hate your brother, so that for me is running around lecturing other people about your perception of their sin because you're trying to achieve your own righteousness by condemning others, that's not a pure heart. That's not loving thy neighbor as thyself. It's that loving, it's like an observation. It's an observation. It's like we in the body of Christ, we live here. We need to observe the world. I don't run around going, oh, no. Yeah, most people don't even give a second thought. I concentrate on what the Holy Spirit has led me to do. Reading those scriptures, doing those videos, walking this glorious gospel of peace, love and truth in every single interaction that I have. I've got a testimony to share in a sec. After the operation, just what happened yesterday, I was feeling just a bit tired, you know, a bit tired and blue. And it was very interesting what happened to me. But I concentrate on those things, as well as whenever somebody's drawn to me, just concentrating and focus on getting that conversation right. And that's my focus. When I go back and I test all these things in prayer, I go back and how did I go? And I deeply ruminate after that prayer as well. I deeply consider it. I go back and I've got that blessing in my office where I don't get a lot of interactions. Like that bike come up there before with the dogs, and I'll consider how I went in that interaction with the Holy Spirit. I'm confident I did well because that guy's focus are those dogs. He's got four dogs, and you can see that man absolutely loves his dogs. He's got a wife as well. She's here some mornings as well. You can see they absolutely love their dogs. So if you give their dogs attention, and you speak to them as well about their dogs, that makes that man happy. So for me, that's a good positive interaction. I've walked in the gospel. Take a moment, pat the dogs, which I love anyway. It's a pleasure because I love dogs. I think they're wonderful. I've always been a dog person. But that's the thing. So you go away and you go, how did I go? How did I actually go in that conversation? And you feel, and there's other conversations where I feel as though at the moment I've got all of these testimonies swirling around me as I talk about these things. So I've got the bloke next door. He's difficult. He's a liar, and I know he's gossiped about me, and he's trashed me behind my back because there's not a soul in that park that are talking to me. No one. No one's talking to me since that bloke came in and started spreading lies about me. Like, I'm okay with the fact he could hear me, no problem. I thank you for telling me, even though I think you've got a 3 o'clock on a Friday afternoon. I think you've got a fairly, you don't have a really long rope of tolerance here. And if you're going to criticize me for talking too loud in my own place, well, then you have to be perfect in that area, which he's not. He's not. He's the loudest voice around the place. But do I go out there, and I would have back in the past, skin full of alcohol, I would have went out and abused the bloke, probably got kicked out of the park because I've reacted to what he did to me, right? But no, just let him go. And I heard him lie. I was in the manager's office when he came to talk to the manager about me. I was standing in the office. He didn't know I was there. The park manager said, just stand in there while I have this talk with him. Because he said to me, he said, you've had complaints. There's been complaints in this park, Brett, about you since day one, about you doing these videos. I said, really? It's the first I've heard of it. So I went up to the manager and I said, is that true? He said, no. He said, what is true is this man's a habitual liar. And as I was standing there, talking to the manager, he came up. He said, quick, go inside. I don't want him to know you're here. I don't want the conflict. So I went inside the office. He didn't know I was there. And he started saying things. He was quite irate and he was very abusive when I got that on film. I thought, no, I'll go back and see how I was. And I'm perplexed. I'm like, mate, it's 3 o'clock in the afternoon. What are you talking about? And since that day, no one at that park's talked to me. So it's not paranoia. It's true. People that were talking to me before. I had that girl that comes up to me sometimes in that park. She's spoken to me since, but she's not coming up as much as she did. But she did. She's spoken to me since. The lady over the road, she said to the girl that comes up to me, and the girl that comes up to me, she said that lady over the road said to me, she says, he's a real nice fellow, that Brett. He's really, really easy to get along with, and he's a lovely bloke. And she used to say hi to me every time she saw me. Now she sees me, and she's almost, this lady's being in her 70s, and she's almost pretty well running to get away from me. So it's not paranoia, right? It's happening. So that now I've got to try to, like, I don't want to talk to this bloke. Unless he comes forward and he confesses to me or does something to alleviate my concerns about him, I've got no trust. I've got no trust in him. And I'm not going to now sit there and talk to him as though there's no problem. So whenever he talks, and he keeps just talking to me, just nice, because he's playing this PR, well, I've done nothing to him. Well, you see, this is what he's like. He's aggressive. He doesn't want to know anybody. This is what he's like. So when he talks to me, I just want nothing to do with him, man. Because I'm not going to say that, but he's unclean. He's not somebody that I want to be dealing with. So I've got that going on. Plus I had the guy on BitChute just cleaving to his doctrine, not listening to me. And then I've also got the guy down at the shops who came to me. He approached me. He demanded that I take an opinion on the Catholic Church, and I declined his demand. No, mate, I want to get to know you more. I'm conscious that that's your religion, and I don't want to go down that path. And then he comes up and he says, I feel you're being hostile toward the church. So I feel as though I've got all of these testimonies going on here now, live, as I do all these things. And then I got that one yesterday. And it's just about the state of your heart. So why don't I want to talk to the bloke next door? It's not because I want to get out to get him and all that. I don't trust him. I just don't trust him, and I'm shaking the dust. There's nothing for me with that man. But the Holy Spirit's put me there for a reason. As that old place gets knocked over, he's put me there for a reason, right? For a purpose. I'm not vindictive. I don't hate him. I'm not establishing my own righteousness because of his lies. I want him to have what I've got. To me, it would make me the happiest man alive if I heard that man say that he's found the Lord Jesus Christ. Nothing would make me happier. I'm not condemning him. I take no satisfaction in what he's done because it's making me... No. I lament. And it's like, but do I now... I don't forgive him. I don't care. It's all good. And that's the difference for me between not forgiving unrepentant sin and just getting on with it. It's not gonna bother me. It would have, but not now. I just get on with it, right? But I don't forgive what he's done. It's just not okay. And that's not gonna... God doesn't forgive him. It's the same with the guy on BitChute. He's cleaving to his doctrine. He won't listen. And I offered him 2 Corinthians. And he just... I actually asked him in the comment, if you don't go and read it, can I ask you why? It'll take you half an hour. Just go and read it. You love the scriptures, don't you? You love the truth. Just go and read it. Please don't take my doctrine away, right? So it's not okay. It doesn't worry me. Whatever. It's not my burden. Same with the guy next door. It's not my burden. It's not a hard heart. It's not a condemnation. It's not a judgment. But it's an assessment. God's the judge, I assess. And for me, what they've all done, the three of those people, what they've all done, it's not okay. But it doesn't bother me. It doesn't bother me in the slightest.
In the slightest?
Well, it doesn't bother me. We'll just say that. It doesn't. Like, I look at the guy I'm bitch shooting, that does bother me. That really gets to me in a way, because I can see that guy, he potentially has a zest for God, and he's been seduced by a harlot. That bugs me. That does bug me. And the guy down at the shops, because he observes a religion, which means he's got some sort of appetite. That bugs me. But the guy next door, I'd rather it not be. I want to live happily with those around me like I did in the other place. But because of his lies, no one talks to me. And it's just my testimony right through my whole life is that people will condemn me and make their assessment on me based on secondhand information without hearing from me. And it just, I'm so used to it. I'm so used to it, isn't funny, right? So then this morning in the bit, and this is the thing with these videos, right? So I'm trying to keep them, I want to keep them an hour and a half, but they're always 2 to 2.5 hours now. And I've just got so much to say. And this is the only chair, well, I've got it with Alex, of course. And I do tell Alex most things. Hello, Alex, if you are watching, if I'm blessed enough to have you watch, mate. But this is really the only, apart from that, it's I want to put it down. This is my diary. This is absolutely my diary. And I want to put down those testimonies, you know. And it's, you just start talking. Sit down here and you just start talking. The run sheet, it's not getting any smaller, right? And this is what I say when I set out. You don't always know the intent, even though there is an intent. So you know the intent, but you don't know how it's going to, you know what I'm trying to say. So then this morning, in the big calendar, yeah, the big calendar, I did the little calendar before. In the big calendar, I got this one in Philippians 2:11. It's very interesting. Check this one out. And that every, right, that says every, not some, not most, that says every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So it's interesting, right? Because clearly in those scriptures, we're going to have the goats go to the left, and they're going to eternal damnation, those that don't believe. They're going to the lake of fire, right? But here we're getting that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So how is the glory of God the Father made manifest? It's made manifest in the Lord Jesus Christ by being made manifest in the body of Christ. That Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. In fact, I'll go there again now, because I've read this a couple of times since I put it down on the video, and I watched it, as I watched it back yesterday on the video, I thought, that's actually what's going on here in Hebrews 2. And I want to share it again just to get it down on this video as well. And I'll pick it up at verse 10. For it became him for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, right? So that's the glory of God, the Father. And every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory and God of the Father. This is that same glory. For it became him for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons, so the sons of God, as our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, as we all become one, as joint heirs, we're going to inherit all things, all becoming one with one another. The Lord Jesus Christ and the Father are one. We're becoming one in them. We're all becoming one as sons, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son, in bringing many sons unto glory, thus to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For both he that sanctifieth and he who are sanctified are all one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. Right? So as I say in the last video, that's what I'm seeing here now, that the captain of our salvation, who is the Lord Jesus Christ, he's going to be made perfect in the sufferings of the body of Christ. Even though he is perfect, but we his body, are not. So that's the finished work for me of the Lord Jesus Christ. When the body of Christ have been made perfect through sufferings, as our lives become his life, thus the captain of our salvation has been made perfect through our sufferings, right? There is something deep going on here about the Godhead, and I've got Acts 17 down here today that I want to talk about with the Godhead as well, because there is something next level going on as it pertains to this Godhead, and I want to do a video purely on the Godhead, but I want to do that one at home. So John 17, 20, neither I pray for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. Right? So what's our word? Our word is the word of God, the Holy Spirit that's dwelling within us, that Holy Spirit given to us due to our sins being washed away, due to that belief that we've inherited, or that belief we've now been gifted with, because we repented. We repented. So what made us repent? Was it a belief, or was it a... Because for me, it wasn't a belief. I didn't repent. My repentance didn't come by believing. My repentance came from, I was like a dog sniffing a trail. It's like, okay, that moon landing's a hoax. Okay, where do we go to now? Then I went to flat earth. Then I went to the two big buildings. Then I went to World War II. And then you get into all of these other conspiracies, you know, like every first lady in America is actually a man. And you get into all these conspiracies, what they call conspiracy theories, right? And I just hunted more truth, because truth became my anchor. And because truth became my anchor, that means I was gonna be led to the truth. And thus I was led to the Lord Jesus Christ. There were signs everywhere, signs and wonders, right? There were signs everywhere. And I got to a point where I wanted to believe that bad. I just couldn't though. I couldn't force myself to believe. Okay, so Jesus, he's come out of the earth, and then he's standing on the earth, and then he just floated away, and we're just going to stand here and just watch it. I couldn't get my head around it. And why create me like this just to condemn me to hell? I couldn't get my head around that. And I got to a point where I wanted to believe that bad. And I was sitting in that church that day, and Pastor Charles Lawson, he shared, John, yes, he's a harlot, absolutely, but he played, it will never lessen. It will never lessen the role, the significant role that man played in my waking up, in my coming to the Lord Jesus Christ. But he shared John 18, 36, 37. And from that moment, I believed. So that's how it happened with me. So I didn't need belief to repent. I needed the Holy Spirit to manifest to me with that man up in Brisbane, my John the Baptist, by giving a man that I respected, a man that I admired, for him to come forward. It had to be him. It couldn't be anyone else, I don't think, back then. It couldn't be anyone else. It had to be that man that asked me to read that book. There would have been no other man that I knew at that time who would have led me to read that book. I would have just been, no, I'm not reading that book. It's a stupid conspiracy theory. I don't want anything to do with it. But I read the book because I respected and admired that man, and then away I went. So that for me is what's happened. So I feel as though just by my testimony, I can absolutely explain, if that's the word, but I can absolutely now see that we do not need that. How do I say? We need the Holy Spirit in order to receive the Word of God. It doesn't come any other way. I received the Word of God by that man being in my life and he asking me to read that book. That was the Word of God. But I'm seeing now the Holy Ghost isn't given until our sins are washed away. Now, because I didn't have that Holy Ghost, I didn't require that Holy Ghost to repent, potentially. I needed the Holy Spirit to manifest to me like he does to every other person, to give them that ability, that opportunity to repent. And then I kept going. I kept going, and I got to a point where I wanted to believe so bad but I just couldn't force myself to it. And I'm not gonna, I got to a point, and nothing's changed, I got to a point where I just couldn't, I couldn't lie to myself. I just couldn't lie to myself and make myself believe in something that I didn't believe in. And I waited and waited and waited, and it took me a couple of years. Like September 2016, and that day at the park with Charles Lawson, John, 1836-37, it happened in June. So it was a couple of years I was awake in the dark. And then from that day on, even that, my belief was not as strong then as what it is now. So it's not true belief, right? Yeah, it is. It's the mustard tree. It's the mustard seed. Because your belief, like I know mine, your belief is going to be stronger in a year than what it is now, right? How? Because of testimony. And then because of that testimony, this comes alive even more. And we're afforded and we're gifted more faith, right? So now it stands to reason that I look back two years ago, well, what was it? It's 4 years ago now. I was sitting in that park and I finally believed. I've got more belief now because I've had more testimony, right? But it's that initial belief. It's that initial belief. And for me, the Holy Spirit just kept coming and coming and coming. He was relentless, right? He was absolutely relentless. And that's absolutely my testimony, that the Holy Spirit just gave me no choice but to repent. But is that because I made the choice to hearken to that? And then I was like a bloodhound man. You couldn't stop me. I didn't care who you were and who you thought you were in my life. Do not come between me and this hunt for the truth. And I lost everything. I lost my whole life. I lost all those people who I thought were friends. Even my family relationship started to fracture. But then because of the purple dragon, that blessed me. And all of those family relationships now are healed because they can see now that I wasn't crazy. It's like, look, I've been telling you. It's exactly what's happening. Oh, the world's getting absolutely mad. Yeah, I've been telling you. I'm not crazy, right? I'm not crazy. It's all inspired. Everything I've been telling you, it's all inspired by the Holy Spirit. So I reckon that's what's going on. Absolutely, that's what's going on. But in any case, we'll come back. I'm not sure where I was, but well, I know I was talking from Hebrews, in Hebrews 2. So it became him for whom are all things and by whom are all things in bringing many sons unto glory to make. So thus, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren, right? Because we're now his friends, because we do his commands. What are his commands? To love each other the way we want to be loved, the way we would treat each other, the way we want to be treated, the way we feel we ought to be treated, and the way we want the Holy Spirit to treat us, and the way the Holy Spirit does treat us if we're following his commands. And that ain't to forgive unrepentant sin, right? So then we come back into John 17, 20, 21. Neither I pray for these alone, but for them also who shall believe on me through their word. Through their word, right? So that's the word of the Holy Spirit that dwells within us. The word of God. The sent preachers who have been sent to lead others who are drawn to repent, which shall believe on me through their word, through their word. So then you come back into the Bible verse of the day in Philippians, that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And back in Hebrews 2, that's the glory. For it became him for whom are all things and by whom are all things in bringing many sons unto glory. That, and this is a thing in Philippians, we're getting that it's every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father, and that's the glory we're getting here. The body of Christ in Hebrews, the body of Christ are being brought, many sons are being brought into that glory, thus the captain of our salvation, the body of Christ, as we all become one, we all become perfect through sufferings, because for both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all one, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren, in the midst of the church I will sing praise unto thee. And back in John 17, neither I pray for these alone, but for them which shall believe on me through their word, the sent preachers, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me, and the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and has loved them, and as thou hast loved me. So for me, Hebrews 2 and John 17 here, they're absolute companion scriptures, and this could be the manifestation that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Because that's what we get back in John 17, that the world that may believe that thou hast sent me, and the glory which thou gavest me I've given them, that they may be one even as we are one. So that's many sons being brought to the glory, thus the captain of our salvation is being made perfect, right? As we all become one. This is the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ for me here, and this absolutely ties into the Godhead. I in them, thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that thou hast sent me and has loved them as thou hast loved me. Thus, every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So that word every becomes just so interesting, next level interesting in Philippians, because not everybody is going to be grafted into the olive tree, right? But that the world may know. That's what we're getting in John. That the world may know that thou hast sent me and has loved them as thou hast loved me. So the whole world is going to know. Every tongue should confess. So there's something deep going on there, right? So this is why I say I wasn't going to read from Philippians, but I've changed my mind. I'm going to do it because this absolutely ties in to all of this. We all becoming one, the sent preachers. Our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. Do unto others what we want done to ourselves, how we want the Father to treat us, how we want the Father to treat everybody else as we become sons. Thus, the Lord Jesus Christ is perfected in the body of Christ. He's finished work, right? Let us labour to enter into that rest. Because when I read through Philippians 2 this morning, I'm going to read Philippians 2 and go through to 17. I'll just go to 17. Because I started to see a real something different here, because it starts out as Paul commanding the body of Christ of how to behave, of how to walk, but then it starts talking about the Lord Jesus Christ himself, and then it starts talking about us again as our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I thought, no, this is just tying into all this again. I'm seeing Hebrews 2 and John 17 here again, all over, right? If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, and of one accord, and of one mind, right? So this is the same as Paul, who's the same as the Lord Jesus Christ, who didn't forgive unrepentant sin. Paul, in fact, condemned people. Paul delivered people to Satan. He called people babblers. He called people all sorts of things. He told us to be wary. He told us to not keep company. He told us that people are dirty and filthy, as did the Lord Jesus Christ, right? As we all become one, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, and of one accord, and of one mind. And this is that difference that I've been trying to reconcile, which I feel now I've absolutely reconciled. Paul did all of that in love. Paul did all of that because he wants people to repent. But he can see the people out there, they won't. So he's talking to the people that have and the people that will. That's what I'm saying. That's what I said last video, that I'm seeing that all of the epistles of Paul are directed to those who've repented. And I'm seeing James, I'm going to share James, that's the plan anyway. Today I'm going to talk about James as well. I'm seeing that James, he's actually speaking to those in Luke 8:15. Those who have received the word on the fertile ground. And that's exactly who Paul's talking to here, right? So to be like-minded, having the same love and of one accord and of one mind. So I think about those three people in my life in a minute. The guy next door, I'm shaking the dust, but my door's always open. The guy I'm bit shoot, exactly the same. I'm shaking the dust and I my door's always open. He's different because with him, I've got a heavy heart. The bloke next door, I see no zest for God whatsoever, none at all. I don't have that heavy heart. I can't manufacture how I feel, right? About people. So is that ungodly because I don't have a heavy heart for him, but I do the other bloke? I do the other bloke on BitChute because I can see he's got some sort of zest for God and he's been seduced by a harlot. But this guy next door, there's just nothing for me. I'm not going to be yoked together with unbelievers, right? I'm shaking the dust from my feet. And the bloke down at the shops, he's still a very, very live. He's still a very, very live prospect and conversation. I'm going to go down there in a few minutes. When I'm done here this morning and I've had my big bowl of porridge, he might come up again today, right? You never know. So it's three very different situations, right? But every one of them, it's not, I'm not being hard towards them. It's nothing like that. It's just discerning the spirits and doing what the Holy Spirit has led me to do with that, what I'm striving to have with a pure heart, right? Fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vain glory. Right? So that's exactly what I'm talking about. Strife or vain glory. Look at you. Look at that sin. Look at that sin. The street preachers. Gay people are going to hell. Going to hell because I'm not gay, so that means I can thump, thump, thump. This lectern that I'm standing behind, and I can be so high and mighty and so righteous because I don't have to deal with that affliction. The bloke next door, no, look at this. No. And you must repent and you must do this. Look at me. Oh, look how great I am because other people are sinning, right? Look at me. That's what Paul's talking about here. But no, go to the Holy Spirit with every conversation. And just want what's best for me and what's best for that person. Want what's best for the Lord Jesus Christ. And go to the Holy Spirit in prayer. And just let your conscience, that Holy Spirit that we've now been blessed with, guide you in all your decisions. So that for me is what Paul's talking about here. As our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the life of the apostles, because their life became the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ's life being an example, and the apostles' life also being an example, and it's on the run sheet here as well, to give some examples of that also in those scriptures. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. So does that pertain to members of the body of Christ, or does that pertain to everybody? So the bloke next door, do I esteem him better than me? Or is this only pertaining to the body of Christ? These are these details for me in those scriptures that hold the key, to all this. Because if I'm meant to be holding that man next door in higher esteem than myself, and I don't want to hold myself in any sort of high esteem whatsoever. It's a key pillar now to my faith is that I stay abased, because this is what it's to be a true soldier in Christ, is to remain abased, to remain humble, not about me. just about the body of Christ and others. But if I look at this now and I hold that guy in higher esteem than me, I think, well, he's God. Does God look at everybody equally? So does God hold you in higher esteem than what he does Anthony Fauci and the Queen? Being led to think he does, as our lives become his life, right? So I don't know, because we look at four, look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. To me, yeah, because that's both. On his own things, but every man also on the things of others. So doing what's best for yourself and those around you, most certainly. But the closing part of verse 3, I'm not sure. Let this mind be in you,
which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. So that's a scripture that absolutely stops me in my tracks every time. Because for me, this goes to the true nature of our reality, most certainly. And it pretty much for me gives it away as to the Lord Jesus Christ is actually God. And it starts to unveil a deeper mystery as well about just about who the sons of God are, the body of Christ, right? So consider, I've been thinking about this. You consider that term, the body of Christ. I did a video on this and I've been saying for quite a few months now, what's the difference, if there is any difference, between the Lord Jesus Christ and the body of Christ? So it came in hard a month or so ago that it's logical. It's logical that the body of Christ is glorious because it's the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. So as I was praying this morning, it just occurred to me that you take out who the actual inhabitants of the body of Christ are, and you just look at the term. You look at the term, nothing pertaining to it. You just look at the term on its own, the body of Christ, and that body of Christ would be part of the Godhead, would it not? And that's what I'm absolutely being led to think. And that's what, for me, Philippians 2:6, it's just a gateway into this truth, this deeper truth becoming revealed as we all become one, as the Lord Jesus Christ and the Father are one, and he's making many sons, he's bringing many sons to glory. Thus, the captain of their salvation will be made perfect. The finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, the perfect unity of faith, the love is the end of the commandment, and we've all become one. The finished work, right? The finished work. And yes, I am back at the homestead. I'm a bit vexed as to what to do because it's been raining, and pretty much as soon as I made the decision to finish this video at the, we'll do this next part, potentially finish it here at the homestead, it was sunny there for a while, but I'm not trusting this weather today. It's not nice out there, and I'm not trusting this weather at all. So I thought, I've made the decision to do it here at the homestead. So it's now, did I record yesterday morning? It's Friday now. It's Friday afternoon. It's about 1 o'clock, 12:30 in the afternoon here. It is the 9th. It's the 9th of September, and I'm up to Revelation 1, and it would be fair to say that I'm absolutely chock-a-block right now with what I want to share. I just feel like I want to share every single last word of this New Testament. There is something coming in monumentally hard now about the blood, the Holy Ghost. I'm seeing now the blood is the Holy Ghost, and we're purified by that blood. Thus, our garments are made white. Because when we're sick, there's a problem with the blood, is there not? I'm going to talk about this more. I want to talk about it right now, but given I'm over an hour already and there's quite a bit here that I still want to, this run sheet's completely changed, but there's a bit here I want to share I want to talk about how the operation went and just a testimony after that as well. And just a couple of things. So the Her Majesty, Her Majesty, she's just, we'll use the term in inverted commas, she's just died. So I want to give some thoughts and ask some questions about that as well. As there's a few things I still want to share, and I also want to share is the tabernacle the inner man, I've got it written down here, and God. So is the actual holy place, is that actually man, and is the most holy place God? And that curtain that divides the holy place and the most holy place, man and God, that's the flesh of the Lord Jesus Christ. I absolutely want to talk about that. And that's potentially where I start up next video. And I still want to talk about how I'm seeing the Lord Jesus Christ in Luke 23 on the cross, the Luke narrative. He was not. Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. He was not looking for the Father to forgive unrepentant sin. It's all in Acts 2 for me. I still want to share that. I absolutely want to share what I'm learning now with the blood, because it all just come to life. The blood come to life, right? The two baptisms, the water, the word, the Lord Jesus Christ. Everybody receives that word, the water baptism, and then the second baptism, we're purified by his blood. So his blood purifies us, because we're no longer sick, and thus he heals our infirmities, right? It's very, very exciting what I'm learning right now, and that's pressing, but it may take a little time, and I want to get a few other things down on this video first. So back here at Philippians 2, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. So I've shared this screenshot before, but I'll just share it again, because John 5:18 for me is, it's a companion scripture. And again, it starts to give away what's happening here. Jesus answered them and said, my Father work hitherto and I work. Therefore, the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. So we get it again, right? We get it again. And the way the Jews, who I am being led to think, are speaking the truth with all of these scriptures, but they're completely mistaken. They're completely wrong about who the Lord Jesus Christ is. But their observations of the scriptures I'm seeing are absolutely dead on, apart from the significant fact that it's pertaining to the Lord Jesus Christ. So John 10, Jesus answered them, many good works have I showed you from my Father. For which of these do you stone me? In verse 33, the Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy, and because that thou, being a man, makest thyself God. So John 10, 32, 33 is telling me that the Jews are saying to the Lord Jesus Christ, because you're claiming you're the Son of God and you're just a man, you're actually making yourself God and you're only a man. That's how I'm reading that. So when we apply John 5:18 and Philippians 2:6, that for me is what's happening. He thought it not robbery to be equal with God, because as the Son, he actually is God. The Son, the Word, the water, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son. And the Father, I'm seeing, is the Holy Spirit, and the blood is the Holy Ghost, the two baptisms. We all receive the water. Out of their bellies will flow torrents, rivers of flowing water, the water of life, the Word of God, right? And then, of course, we get in, well, in verse 34, Jesus answered them, is it not written in your law, ye are gods? Israel is my son, even my firstborn. Exodus 4:22. And we also get it in the congregation of the mighty. I have said ye are gods, because they're the sons, plural, of God. And the Lord Jesus Christ, he's being told here, we're being told that the Lord Jesus Christ, because he's claiming he's the Son, saying he's equal with the Father, he's actually making himself God, because he is God. That's what we get in 1 Timothy 3:16. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. Now, in terms of whether the Lord Jesus Christ is God or not, I don't quite understand how it's a debate when you look at 1 Timothy 3:16. God was manifest in the flesh. That's been my understanding. The way I've reconciled this for quite some time is, what if God wanted to be a man? How would that look? So God's like, okay, I'm going to go down there. Because one thing now, we can't say to God, well, you don't know what it's like. You don't know what it's like to dwell in these carnal bodies. So what if God said, well, okay, I'm going to go down to the earth and I'm going to manifest as a man? That was the Lord Jesus Christ, right? And the Lord Jesus Christ, as that man, that's who he was praying to. He was praying to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit also that dwells within him, but it's the same as us today. The Holy Spirit dwells within us and we pray to that Holy Spirit in heaven. It's the same thing, right? The Son of God and the sons of God. So the Lord Jesus Christ is God. God was manifest in the flesh. I have said, ye are gods. And because thou makest thyself, without being a man, you make yourself God, because you're claiming that you're the Son of God and you're making yourself equal with God. So that means for me, it's pretty clear for me now that the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is in fact God. I have said, ye are gods. So then John 19, now I've got verse 7 and 21 from John 19 here, copy-pasted. And I've titled this one, Jesus as the Son was God. The Jews answered him, we have a law, and by our law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God. So that's the accusation. That's why the Jews killed the Lord Jesus Christ, because he made himself the Son of God. That meaning he was God himself. So the Lord Jesus Christ being the Son, that's he's claiming that he's actually God himself, because he thought it not robbery to be equal with God as the Son. Now the John 19 narrative of the sign, which of course is different in all four narratives, but the John 19 narratives of the sign, then said the chief priests of the Jews to Pilate, write not the King of the Jews, but he said, I am King of the Jews, right? Because that's the accusation. That's the big difference here. The actual sign in this narrative said the King of the Jews, which for me means he is God. And they're saying, no, he's claiming to be God. So write instead, he's claiming he is the King of the Jews. John 1, Nathanael answered and said unto him, Rabbi, thou art the Son of God. Thou art the King of Israel, which for me is the King of the Jews, right? Isaiah 44:6, thus saith the Lord, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of the celestial bodies, the Lord of hosts. Now, I've been seeing for quite some time that the Lord of hosts is actually the Holy Spirit. And I'm starting to wonder now, as I sit here right now and I see that word Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I'm really starting to wonder if that's actually the Holy Ghost. That's actually the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, because it's the blood that redeems. It's the blood that purifies. It's the blood that washes away from sin. I'm seeing now the first baptism, it takes all those sins away that we've previously committed. It takes them out of the way and we're washed clean and we start again. Sin's taken out of the way. But we're still these carnal entities who still sin. But due to the progression of faith, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost that comes within us, our blood is then purified by that blood of Christ. Hence, we're saved from our sins. The purification, the progression of faith, that when he comes back, the Lord Jesus Christ comes back, he will say to us, just like Nathanael, he said to Nathanael, aha, now that's a true Israelite in whom is no guile, because you've been purified with the blood, the white raiment, right? And this white raiment for me, it's tying in right now to this queen dying. Believe it or not, because Satan's a counterfeiter, an earthly story, a parable with a heavenly meaning, right? But for me, John 1, 49 and Isaiah 44, 6 is directly telling us that the Lord Jesus Christ is the Lord. Jehovah, H3068, because there's only one king of Israel. But it's interesting that because there was many kings of Israel in the Old Testament. But this is the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ, as the Son of God, he's the King of Israel. Now, the Jews said, no, don't write he's actually the King of the Jews. So don't write that he's actually God, the Lord, the King of Israel. Don't write that. Write that he's actually saying that that's who he is. That's who he's claiming he is, because he's saying that he's the Son of God. Plural Son of God, remembering that the body of Christ are the sons of God. I have said ye are gods, as we all become one in each other, as we all become one in God and the Father, who are also one as joint heirs, and we're going to inherit all things, right? The Godhead. Thus saith the Lord, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. I am the first, I am the last, beside me there is no God. So that's what the Lord Jesus Christ says in Revelation as well. We get it in red writing. I am Omega, the beginning and the end. We get it in red writing, and we also get it in black writing, because there's no difference. It's the Lord Jesus Christ and the Father. It's all part of this three aspects of God. Father, Son, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, which is, for me, the blood. The Holy Spirit, the water, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Word, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, the blood. And it's that blood that purifies us. So for me, John 19:21 and Isaiah 44:6 is saying directly the Lord Jesus Christ is God. Zechariah 9, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion, O daughter of Jerusalem, which for me is the body of Christ, the daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, thy king cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation and lowly riding upon an ass and upon a colt, the foal of an ass. So I still don't get that. A stubborn beast of burden, an ass, a mule, a donkey. But, O daughter of Jerusalem, O daughter of Zion, thy king cometh to thee. And the Lord Jesus Christ, he fulfills this in Matthew 21 and verse 4 and 5, all this was done, it was fulfilled, as was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell ye the daughter of Zion, behold, thy capital K king, which is what we get in Zechariah 9, the capital K king of Jerusalem, Zion, is the king of Israel, who is the Lord, Hebrew word H3068, Jehovah, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. It's coming in right, real hard as I put down this part of this video, that the Redeemer is actually the Holy Ghost, the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, because that's what redeems. Nathanael says, thou art the Son of God, thou art the King of Israel, and that was the accusation of the Jews. Don't put on the sign that he's actually the King of the Jews, saying he is the King of the Jews, because that's why we're crucifying, because he's claiming that he's actually God, and he thought it not robbery to be equal with God, and thou being a man, you're making yourself God, as God was manifest in the flesh. And that's what I'm seeing here, most certainly in Philippians 2:6, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Now, this is what I say the other day, well, yesterday when I was down at the park, is that this changes, because here we're getting, this is all about the body of Christ. Now here, it starts to change. It now speaks about the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, when we come further down, it starts to talk about the body of Christ again. Because as I say before, this is directly written, this is directed at those who have repented, who have been purified by the blood, by the Holy Ghost. That's who this is directed at. So that's who Paul, yes, it's Philippians. That's who Paul's talking about. He's talking about the body of Christ, those who have actually repented. So that's the thing. We all become one as joint heirs, the Godhead, the body of Christ. Of course, the body of Christ is glorious. And of course, the body of Christ is a part of the Godhead, right? The finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. But made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. So we get that word here again, the likeness of men. So does that mean he was set apart? He was like men, or he was a man? He was just like us. just like you're just like me, and I'm just like you. That's what I'm being led to think we're getting here, in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself. Now, and being found in fashion as a man, and he made himself, right, of no reputation. Now, that's what this is pertaining to. The Lord Jesus Christ, he didn't make himself of any reputation while he was here. But what I'm seeing here now on a deeper level is because the Lord Jesus Christ is actually God, but here he's being made manifest in the flesh. So Jehovah has made. I don't know if the Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh is a created entity or not. I don't want to be controversial and start claiming things like that. But he was most certainly made. He was in the form of God, and he was fashioned as a man. And for me, he was made. So Jehovah, this is how he made the Lord Jesus Christ himself in the flesh. The Lord Jesus Christ didn't just come to the earth and said, no, I'm not going to be of any reputation. That's how God made himself. So for me, God has made the Lord Jesus Christ to be of no reputation, to be in the form of a servant, in the likeness of man, to be humbled and to be obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. This is how God made himself in the flesh, the Lord Jesus Christ. Wherefore God hath highly exalted him and hath given him a name which is above every name. So exalted him, right? So those of low degree will be exalted, the body of Christ. And for me, that's the biggest gift right now I can have, is that God is glorified in me, thus God is glorified, exalted in the Lord Jesus Christ, and given him a name which is above every name. Now, this is the Bible verse of the day. Which one was it? It was verse 11. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. So that tells me we've got three different worlds going on here in our current system. For me, it's a enclosed system. It's geocentric. Everything revolves around the earth. Everything revolves around us. We're the only thing that's not moving. Potentially, is it Polaris? Potentially it's not moving as well, but it might be. I'm not sure. But the earth doesn't move. The earth doesn't move. But we've got things in heaven which revolve around the earth, things in earth, and also things under the earth. So we've got three different worlds in our current reality. But we get this word every, and that's what we get it again. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So that's the Bible verse of the day from, it was yesterday. So it would have been yesterday. I was down at the park. Because if every tongue confesses that the Lord Jesus Christ is Lord, we can only do that by the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12:3, right? You can only confess that the Lord Jesus Christ is Lord by the Holy Spirit. We're getting every tongue should confess. So there's something deeper going on here that I can't yet find rest on. Wherefore, my beloved, right? So now we're talking about the body of Christ again. So we're talking about the body of Christ to here, and then we talk about the Lord Jesus Christ, because he's an example. So we've been made, for me, we've been made the same way. We've been purified by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. But the Lord Jesus Christ didn't have that. He didn't have that. He didn't have the Holy Ghost wasn't yet given like it has been to us. He was God manifest in the flesh, and he's done it. And his life now is an example for us. And that's, for me, is why Paul's doing this. That's why he's talking about how the Lord Jesus Christ was made by Jehovah himself as a man. Now, this is what we do. We follow his steps. And as we all become one, the body of Christ, this is what's going to be happening for me to the body of Christ as well. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. So it's just so interesting that it's interesting on a few levels, because when I went to the church, the last church I went to a few years ago now, up just up the road here, where the pastor rejected my testimony, This is where he actually preached from. He preached from this scripture. It was the only scripture he really talked about all sermon, but it was interesting sermon, and that's what this is the scripture he focused on. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God, right, which worketh in you both to will and to do his good pleasure, right, to will. I'm just going on memory. But for me, this is the I can't think of it. But it's like the pleasure of God. It's the want of God. It's the desire of God in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. The progression of faith, now that we've had the water baptism, now as the blood purifies us inside, thus we're healed of our infirmities, we're now doing good works in his name, right? So to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, this for me goes a long way to explaining as to why the majority of us are just on our own. We're just doing this all by ourselves. There are some people out there that are blessed to have a husband or a wife that are sharing their walk as well, but you're also alone, right? We're not surrounded by people. We're all alone in this hostile environment, planet Babylon. The God of this world, sin himself, this world for me that was set up for sin so that the body of Christ could defeat sin in a carnal body that was made only for sin, that the Holy Ghost, the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, can redeem us, can purify us, that God is glorified in the body of Christ, thus the God is glorified in the Lord Jesus Christ, right? And two of my most favorite scriptures of all scripture, check this out, I love this. Do all things without murmurings and disputing, that you may be blameless and harmless, right? That you may be blameless, because we need to continue. And as I go on and on, that guy that commented on BitChute on my other video, for me, it's turned into one red hot testimony for me, because I'm now seeing this more and more and more. And I got a calendar. Yeah, it was today. The big calendar and also the little calendar today. That's just absolutely going to this. It's just amazing that guy coming forward. That you may be blameless, right? So this only comes by the Holy Spirit. This only comes by the Lord Jesus Christ. The water, the word, and the Holy Ghost, the purification of the blood of Christ. Thus we no longer have infirmities, right? The progression of faith, the Galatians 5 purge, that you may be blameless and harmless, right? That this is what's going to save us from the wrath to come. It's not words, it's not what we think, it's not what we believe. Well, it is what we believe, if we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, but it's not us believing our way into a lie. It's about, because we've had the progression of faith, the purification by the blood, thus we're going to be in this form, because we know God, because we have his Holy Spirit. The only way we can know God is by his Holy Spirit. And then 1 John, it's 3 for memory, where we're going to see him for as he is, because we're going to be just like him, because we've all become one in him. The progression of faith, a true Israelite in whom is no guile, that you may be blameless and harmless, the sons, plural, of God, right? So we're being purified by the blood, the Holy Ghost, and again, the Lord Jesus Christ, he's equal with God. He thought it not robbery to be equal with God. And many good works have I shown you from my Father. We're not stoning you. We're not stoning you for your good works. We're stoning you for blasphemy, because thou being a man, you've made yourself God, as God was made manifest in the flesh. And he is this sign said, I am the King of the Jews, which is the King of Israel, which is the Lord. And they said, no, no. Put on the sign, I have said, I am King of the Jews, because that's what they're saying here. You being a man, you're a deceiver. You're saying you're actually God, because you're saying that you're the Son of God. But Jesus' response, is it not written in your law? I have said ye are gods, because I'm God manifest in the flesh, and you're my sons. Well, you aren't, but the sons of God are, and that's what we're getting here. That you may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God. This is the perfect unity of the faith, the body of Christ, all becoming one with one another, one with the Father and God, who are of course one. We all become one, the sons of God, the Godhead. So I'm saying, I've been wanting to put that down for a long time, that I'm seeing the body of Christ absolutely part of the Godhead. For me, it's everywhere. It's absolutely everywhere. Without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Why? Because that light is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that's purifying us inside, the perfect work, the perfect finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ, that we all become one. Thus, our raiment has been washed clean by the blood, right? The white. This goes into the Queen, because I'll get to that at the end. I'll get to that at the end. But that's the white raiment for me. It's purified. When our blood is completely purified, we're now wearing that perfect white raiment. And that's how the Lord Jesus Christ, that was the transfiguration. Holding forth the word of life. Right, so the water, the Lord Jesus Christ, the baptism, the word of life, out of their belly will flow rivers, torrents of living water, right? The sons of God, the sent preachers, preaching the baptism of repentance. Holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. Yea, and if I be offered upon the sacrifice and service of your faith, I joy and rejoice with you all. So I've been wanting to put down Philippians 2 for quite some time. It does go a little bit further, but just for the sake of time, I'm just gonna press on now. So that's what I'm absolutely saying. The unity of the body of Christ, as we all become one with the Father and one with the Lord Jesus Christ. And they're already, well, one with each other and one with the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So I said, I think, anyway, but they're already one, right? Remember I said a few videos ago, it'd be probably 10 or so ago now, about the heart of the city and the pulse of the city, right? So the heart of the city is Zion, which is the heart of God, that new heart he gives us. So it's that heart that's pumping the blood, the Holy Ghost, through us, and it's that blood that's purifying us. It's like we're getting a blood transfusion of type. It's gradually, I'm seeing that, because if the blood of Christ can only be on its own, that means as soon as you get it, you're perfected. And that's not my testimony. Unless we haven't received the Holy Ghost yet, which also isn't my testimony. And for me, that's the Galatians 5 purge. All of those attributes get purged out, and gradually, day in, day out, gradually but surely, the Holy Spirit's come in, the purification of our blood, the purification of the Holy Ghost, of the blood of Christ, right? And that's most certainly what I'm seeing here. So that's what I say, that we're getting, it's like we're getting a blood transfusion, and every day with testimony, we get more and more and more, but we have to continue to that final day, because that blood yet hasn't been totally purified, because we're not yet wearing that perfect white raiment. That's what I'm starting to see. It's still a bit foggy, that part, but that's most certainly what I'm saying. So a question. Alex down at the shops, he asked me a question yesterday, very interesting question. He just said, does everyone know right from wrong? I went, oh. It's interesting, I asked Mum later as well. Mum went, yeah, yeah. And Alex, I think you said yes as well, mate. So if I'm blessed enough to have you watching, and I think so. Everybody knows right from wrong. Like, they dress people up now with mental disorders, and they give them, and I'm not saying that these, I'm not saying it's not true, but what I'm saying is that what they've labelled this whole mental health thing, for me, that's a ruse. But for me, the actual how people feel, that for me is very real. People get down, people get blue, but the whole mental health thing is just to get people on pharmacia, right? And that's what, I mean, you look at these serial killers throughout the history of the world and the like, and you start to wonder, I start to wonder, were they just false stories? Did they actually happen? But then, because then they get to push this mental illness, right? And just this page, I've just stumbled across this young girl. I'm actually going to recommend a YouTube page today. Amazing, right? I never thought I'd ever do that again. But a part of that, as I see it, is so they can dismiss this in some, because you look at these rancid, like the people that apparently knocked down the two great towers, and you look at somebody like the head of the royal family back in 1930s Germany, they didn't know right from wrong, right? Because they're just so evil, they're so heinous. Yeah, they did. And that's what I'm being led to think as well, is that everybody actually knows right from wrong. So then I've written here, is the right actually the word of God, and wrong is actually the word of Satan? The corrupt seed of Satan, the father of this world, and the word of God being the seed, the water, and the sun. So we're all corrupt. We're all just condemned under the law. So if you're born into the world where you're condemned under the law, because so the Lord Jesus Christ can save us, that means you're just riddled with death. And what's death? For me, it's Satan. That's what this is. It's translating us from the grips of Satan, and there's scripture to absolutely say what I'm saying here is in truth, that we're getting translated from the grips of Satan, eternal death and bondage and corruption, the corrupt seed, by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, the purifying blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, we're being redeemed. And that's absolutely what I'm saying. Wrong is that. Right, so wrong is the seed of the serpent. See, wrong is the word of the serpent. All of this deception on the earth, that's wrong. And that's war that's going on inside us. That war, I want to talk about that today as well. The war between the mind and the war of the mind, flesh versus spirit, right? The old man and the new man. There's most certainly this internal war going on, and it's also being fought externally, as these creatures run the world. They will do anything to keep us in the grips of bondage, in the grips of Satan, under the condemnation of the law, right? As we get, you repent, you take that choice to repent, and then you're given that gift to believe, and then once you believe, that's when you start receiving the blood, right? I mean, how about that? This is what I say. I want to put this down better in my next video, but this is just incredible. That's what the blood of Christ is. It actually, the blood of Christ, it's what actually redeems us. It purifies us, and we get that blood by faith. We get that blood due to faith, thus our testimony grows. The testimony, right? Our testimony is the word of God, which is the Holy Spirit, or it might be the Holy Ghost, right? These things I'm not completely sure of yet. But that I found that a really interesting question. Everyone knows right from wrong. So then you go, well, okay, so everybody's born into a world that's corrupt. I'm being led to think that everybody receives the seed, the word of God, the water. The water's there. Here it is. All you got to do is repent, and you will receive. You will receive that water, and all of your sins will be washed clean. And then you believe, and then you receive the Holy Ghost, which is the blood that's actually going to purify you. But you've got to keep going, right? So now I look at that and I think, well, right and wrong. Everyone knows right and wrong. So everybody, I don't know, the spirit of God and the spirit of man, does everybody know that they should repent? I can't remember. Like I look back then, And I think to myself, deep down, yeah, I think back then I would have known it. But did I actually know it? Was I aware I knew it? Well, if I deep down now, I think I knew it, right? And I knew it. Yeah, I reckon I knew it. And it's a choice. For me, it's absolutely a choice. And that's what happened to me. So I say in the video, in my testimony, that's most certainly what happened to me. The Holy Spirit just kept coming. Just kept coming and coming and coming because I kept going. I just kept going. I didn't turn my back on this. I kept going and I lost everything. I lost my career. I lost my place up there. I lost all my friends who I thought were my friends. I just lost my life. My life is just, it's ruined. Without the Holy Ghost now, that Holy Spirit dwelling within me now, I got nothing. I would be, you talk about mental illnesses, I would just be, I wouldn't be able to function. I just shudder to think. You just get to a point, I'm sure it's your testimony too, it's like, why would you stop? It's like what Simon Peter says, well, where are we going to go? Where are we going to go, right? And that only comes by testimony. And it's that testimony that's the blood, the purification. It's just incredible how all of this now is starting to connect, all this stuff that I've been previously working on. So I got another comment on BitChute, and so far I haven't received a subsequent comment, and I do sense that this could very well be, I see it as a truth bombing, the truth bombing spirit. The truth bombers come on and they just say, that's it, this is what the truth is. And it's not open for any discussion. They're just, they tell you what the truth is, and then that's it. So this person says, the righteous man judgeth everything. And I think, okay, so that sounds like it's one scripture. You've taken one scripture, and then that's it. We're not gonna look at every other scripture. But I thought, interesting. It's an interesting comment, right? That's why I've asked them, is that in reference to 1 Corinthians 2:15? Because I put those terms, righteous and judge, and it's just from memory, those two words, I don't see those two words together as it pertains to man. I see it as it pertains to God, who is the judge. But 1 Corinthians 2:15, but he that is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. So for me, that's pertaining to the same thing. Because to be spiritual, you need to be right. Well, you become righteous. You can't be righteous unless you're spiritual. And you're only spiritual once you've received the blood. And you only receive the blood after you've been washed clean because you believe, because you've repented, right? And 1 Corinthians 12:3, of course, nobody can call the Lord Jesus Christ Lord but by the is it the Holy Ghost or the I have to check that. Is it the Holy Ghost or is it by the Lord? Or I'll put it up on screen. That's interesting. As soon as I stop recording, I'll check that one out, because that just becomes next level interesting for me now as well. So as I say, to this moment, I haven't received a comment, and apologies to Even and Low. Is that what it says? Even and Low. If you have subsequently commented after that, but given you haven't commented so far, and I'm thinking you're not going to further comment, it's looking to me now like this is just a truth bomb. But I think of it and I look at it and I think, well, I see they haven't, they may have, but this is why I wanted to converse with them. Have you actually considered Matthew 7? Have you considered these things that I've been talking about? It was Romans 2:1. You do these things, you judge, you're just condemning yourself, mate. You're just condemning yourself, oh man. So have you considered those scriptures? Because for me to take one scripture in isolation, it's pretty simple, right? It's pretty simple to do that. But then I think of it, and I've done many videos on this before. So Leviticus 9 is the scripture where we actually receive the commandment, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. So verse 15, you shall do no unrighteousness in judgment, that thou shalt respect the person of the poor, nor honour the person of the mighty, but in righteousness thou shalt judge thy neighbour. So they are together, aren't they? The righteous man judgeth everything. The righteous man judgeth anything. So I don't know what this search was that I did now. But in righteousness, thou shalt judge thy neighbor. So this goes to the comment. The righteous man judges everything. You shall do no unrighteousness in judgment. So you're not going to respect the person of the poor, nor honor the person of the mighty, but you're just going to judge in righteousness. Shall they judge thy neighbor? So the Lord here is commanding members of the children of Israel, for me, the Old Testament body of Christ, to do what he does, to judge the sons of God, right? Now, that's what we get in Psalm 82. God stands in the congregation of the mighty. He judges among the gods. So that's what I'm seeing here. These are all companion scriptures for me. All of these here tie into each other. I'm being led to think we're addressing the congregation of the mighty here, but in Psalm 82, we get a manifestation of these gods. Is it not written in your law? I have said you are gods, right? But they're not doing it. They're judging unjustly, and they're not defending the poor and fatherless. So they're not doing, even though it says thou shalt not respect the person of the poor, this means, for me, this means it doesn't matter who they are, you just judge righteously, right? You judge righteously. But in Psalm 82, they're not doing it. They're not doing what Leviticus 19 was commanded. And that's what absolutely what we get in Jeremiah 7. Stand in the gate of the Lord's house, right? So what's that? That's the body of Christ. And that's what I'm seeing here. This is the body of Christ, the congregation of the mighty. The body of Christ in the Old Testament. That body had to be destroyed. Zion had to be leveled. It's the same land. It's the same land. It's the same body. The Lord Jesus Christ was resurrected in the same body. But it all had to be destroyed. The temple had to be destroyed so the new one would be reared up by the purification of the body of Christ, right? So stand in the gate of the Lord's house and proclaim there this word, the word of God, the water, the sun, and say, hear the word of the Lord, all ye Judah that enter in at these gates to worship the Lord. So entering into the body of Christ, right? And thus saying the Lord of hosts, right? So the Lord of the celestial body, the Redeemer. I'm being led to think, this is what I'm going to test when I start the Old Testament in a few days again. I'm going to test whether this is actually the blood of Christ, the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel. So we get, he's actually the God of Israel, right? Back in my screenshot here, we're getting the Lord is the King of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. And here we're getting the Lord of hosts himself is actually the God of Israel, right? The King of Israel, because it's the same. I'm being led to think that this is most certainly the blood of Christ, and Jehovah is the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost and the Holy Spirit, the God of Israel. Amend your ways and your doings, and I will cause you to dwell in this place. Trust you not in lying words, saying the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord are these, right? Your corruptions. Now, if you thoroughly amend your ways and your doings, and if you thoroughly execute judgment between a man and his neighbor, if you press not the stranger and the fatherless and the widow and shed not innocent blood in this place, neither walk after other gods to your hurt. And it goes on to say, then you will then dwell in my place, in my house. So they're not doing it. They're not doing the command in Leviticus 19 that they're being accused of not doing. Well, told directly they're not doing in Psalm 82. So for me, this is all the congregation of the mighty. This is all the body of Christ in the Old Testament. This is all the sons of God, right? Now, they're meant to be doing it. The sons of God are meant to be doing it. And Matthew 23, that's what the Lord Jesus Christ tells the scribes and the Pharisees, right? So it's interesting because the Lord Jesus Christ says, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, exclamation point. Now, the Lord Jesus Christ isn't there just saying, woe to you, scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites. Right, it's got an exclamation point. Woe to you, he's going off. Now he was meek and he didn't answer back and he submitted himself to God, the righteous judge, and he was obedient to death. Meek and didn't snap back. But in Matthew 23, he's told him exactly how it was. Now I'm not saying we go out and start carrying on like that. No, I'm not. I don't feel anywhere near worthy to carry on like that. But for me, it's carry on. For me, it would be carrying on. But the Lord Jesus Christ does, it's not carrying on. But for me, that it just tells me there's something deeper to consider here, because it was Mark 5 for memory that the Lord Jesus Christ actually got angry. And for me, that goes in, that absolutely goes in the face of the gospel, being angry. But the Lord Jesus Christ did it, right? But he says, you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. So faith's in the law, mercy's in the law, and judgment's in the law, because the Lord Jesus Christ is accusing the Pharisees of omitting these things, because for me, the Pharisees are meant to be doing it. The Pharisees were in that role, and for me, the Lord Jesus Christ is acknowledging that they're actually in the role. He's saying that they're, yes, they're actually in this role that was being commanded here in Leviticus 19. It's the same entity. For me, these are, not these here, because these would be dead. I'm being led to think that there's something with time and death in those scriptures. But for me, this is the Pharisees here. It's the same thing, right? Which leads me to think we've got the Pharisees here. We've got the Pharisees here. And we've absolutely got them as well in Jeremiah 7. And he's saying that you're omitting the weightier matters of the law of judgment, being one of them, right? So then we come back to this comment, the righteous man judgeth everything. So it's an interesting comment, right? Because that, for me, in the Old Testament, is actually absolutely what the command is. But get this one. So I've done this screenshot up a few times. So the Lord Jesus Christ in Matthew 19, he says, When those who have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, you shall also sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel, right? So we all become one. So the Lord Jesus Christ is sitting upon the throne of his glory. He's going to be sitting upon the throne with the Father as we all become one with one another and one with them. So we're going to be sitting upon 12 thrones, the 12 tribes of Israel. Just another scripture that leads me to think that everybody in the body of Christ is actually of a tribe of Israel. Every one of us are of a tribe of Israel, sitting upon 12 thrones, but judging, right? Judging the 12 tribes of Israel. But in 1 Corinthians 4:4, for I know nothing by myself, yet am I not hereby justified, but he that judges me is the Lord. Therefore, judge nothing before the time, until the Lord come, who will both bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the hearts, and then shall every man have praise of God. Right? So, judge nothing before the time. Now, this for me is tying into this judgment, which is to come. Absolutely, most certainly. But we come back to the comment, the righteous man judgeth everything, right? This for me, it goes to the outcome of the progression of faith, but it's also we need to have that judgment now in us. It's about why. Why are we saying these things in prayer? Why are we saying these things to each other? Why are we saying these things in a video, right? I'm not saying anything about this bloke next door because I want to. It's not like that. I'm just sharing your testimony, trying to make sense of what I'm supposed to do, and I'm judging the situation. I'm making judgment on that man's character because I've got to proceed, right? We're to try all the spirits. Now, for me, there's two different things going on here, most certainly. The righteous man judgeth everything. That could mean anything. This is what I say with the truth-bombing spirit. This could mean anything. He could be saying that it's about this. And for me, we're not to do this. This for me is going to happen at the end, that judgment. But we're to make assessments. Because once we cast the beam from out of our own eye, we're going to be able to help others cast the mote from out of their eye due to the blood, due to the purification, right? So it's like, don't judge people, but you need to assess characters. That for me is where it is. And it's just about the state of your heart, right? But 1 Corinthians 6, dare any of you having a matter against each other, go to the law before the unjust. Could you imagine, right? So you're going before people who have put themselves under the law, people who have put themselves back under bondage, those who have reneged on their repentance, those who don't have the Holy Spirit, those who are not being purified by the blood. That's what Paul's saying here. Why would you do that? And not before the saints? Because the saints have the blood, right? Do you not know that the saints will judge the world? Right? But in 1 Corinthians 4:5, judge nothing before the time. It's not time yet, right? Judge nothing before the time. Do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And if the world will be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters? No, you're not. We shall judge angels. And how much more things that pertain to this life? We got to judge angels, right? And that's what we get in thousand-year reign. I saw thrones, and they that sat on them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God. Wow, I'd never seen that before. It's not even highlighted. How about that? Were beheaded for the witness of Jesus, so the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. That's the thing now. That's the thing. And you will receive, Acts 2:38 says ghost, right? The blood, the redemption. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Beheaded for the witness of Jesus. So the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus that dwells within us. Holy Spirit and the blood. But it just, it just becomes exciting now. But for the word of God. So the word of God for me is the word of God. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the Son. It's the water. You receive the word of God, which leads you to repent. And we continue to receive the word of God as we get purified by the blood. It's all part of testimony, right? But we're getting entities here on planet Babylon who've been beheaded for the word of God. So that for me would be a prophet in the Old Testament, right? Because that's what they were doing. That's what the prophets were doing. Amend your ways. Repent. This is the water. Here it is. Come and wash yourself clean in the water. That's what they were doing right through, right? And those which hadn't worshipped the beast, neither his image, nor received the mark on their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. So those who didn't receive or worship the image of the beast, etc., for me, that's 144,000. As I go on and on, that's what I'm seeing, is the 144,000... they're the ones standing at the end. There's nobody else at the end that's not in the 144,000. That's just what I'm saying now. And I just read this in Jude, so I thought I'd add it. And Enoch also, the seven from Adam, prophesies of these saying. Now, a lot of people who say that book Enoch should be in Scripture. Now, I'm not one of those people, by the way. I've read Enoch a few times. I've done a video on it, and I think Enoch's a very, very dark pit, and it's has no place in Scripture whatsoever. But they say, a lot of people say, that this is why Enoch is in Scripture, because it says Enoch prophesies of these. It doesn't say he wrote anything down there. It doesn't say that he wrote a book of Scripture. It just says he prophesies. For me, prophesies could just be being led to think it would have been written down, but this does not say it's in Scripture at all. It's just saying that Enoch prophesies of these saying, behold, the Lord cometh with tens of thousands of his saints to execute judgment upon all and to convince. So that's convict all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have ungodly committed, and all of their hard speeches, which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. So it's judgment, right? It's the ultimate judgment. It's the patience of the saints coming to light, coming to the fore. So it's all about judgment. But in Jude, we're reading that it's going to be these tens of thousands of his saints are going to execute this judgment. I'm seeing potentially it's the same judgment as the thousand-year reign that the saints, Paul, is promising to in Corinthians are going to judge, that the Lord Jesus Christ speaks about in Matthew 19. Those who take part in the resurrection, those who aren't subject to the second death, will take part in the first resurrection. The second death has no impact on them. They're gonna live with Christ for this thousand-year reign, then go into new city, and they're going to sit upon these 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And I look at Jude, and I just start to wonder again if this is the 144,000. And I put that down a little incorrectly before of what I was saying about the 144,000. What I said is, yeah, that's what I'm being led to think, that anybody left standing at the end who don't take the mark of the beast, etc., they're a part, the 144,000. But I'm not saying that those that have gone before may not be a part of the 144,000. But everybody left standing at the end, for me, most certainly are a part of the 144,000. And I'm 50-50 right now as to whether the 144,000 are only they standing at the end, or whether they've been accumulated throughout all history. So you look at, I only see the two figures in Scripture, Enoch and Elijah. They're the only two that didn't see death. They went to be with God. Enoch, his testimony pleased God. I'm being led to think Elijah's the same. Are they part, the 144,000? These great figures in the Scriptures, such as Moses and Samuel and all the rest of them, Job and Noah and Abraham, are they all, and all the prophets, are they all part of the 144,000? I don't know, but I'm strongly being led to think that anybody who's left standing at the end, they're a part of the 144,000. It's part of the separation. But that's what I see here. I've been seeing in these scriptures for a while that we're getting the old. So I'm seeing the old here, the old being purged out. And that's what the Lord Jesus Christ says in Matthew 23. And in Matthew 26, the Lord Jesus Christ, he actually says to these scribes and Pharisees that you had this kingdom and now you've lost it, and I'm going to now give it to the Gentiles. I'm going to give it to a nation who's going to bring forth the fruits thereof for me, the body of Christ. But so I see all this as pertaining to the Pharisees. This is out with the old and this is in with the new. So it's an interesting comment, right? It's a really interesting comment. I'm not seeing, as I say, I'm not seeing this as this at all. All this. No. For me, this is the thing with the truth bombers, though. You don't quite know. But I feel like I'm getting closer with this whole judgment thing. It's about the state of your heart. And that's what this person could well be talking about. It's truth bombing. You just don't know. You just don't know what they're saying, because they just drop and run, and they just don't engage in any more conversation. It doesn't even frustrate me anymore. It is just what it is. But I'm going to share my thoughts in a sec about the Queen. And I ask you, when you first heard the news of the, we'll say everything we're getting told about the Queen and about them dying and they don't come back to life and they're just people just like the rest of us. She died just like everybody else does. So let's look at it through that lens. How did that actually make you feel? Now, when I sit here and speak about the Queen, I say just openly that I think she's just, her and the Pope are probably the most vile and evil people on the face of the earth that I can see. Am I judging them? Am I falling into condemnation in Romans 2:1 and Matthew 7? For me, it's different, because I take no delight. I take no delight in their evil at all. And for me, my righteousness has not improved because of their wickedness. I just want them all to repent. I mean, it wouldn't make me anything happier than to hear the Queen's actually repented. But it's like what Brad, you said in your comment, mate. It just gets to a point. It gets to a point where they just can't. And I think, well, they're giants, so they potentially can't anyway. But anyway, I feel as though I'm getting a little bit closer to it. It's just about the state of your heart. And it's, you just want everybody to come to repentance. You want everybody to have what we've got, right? So it's an interesting comment, and it really made me think, and it reminded me. It reminded me a few parts of Scripture that I've learned in the past, and that's always good. I got that today in a Bible, well, yesterday in the little calendar. It was good. It was a real pertinent reminder, just a big Scripture in Proverbs. It was a pertinent reminder. And that's the thing, you learn so much when you're doing this. Like, you got my office, as I'm sure the brothers and sisters out there can attest to as well. You learn so much, and you tend to forget. You probably forget, I don't know, that's probably not right, but you forget a lot. You just can't retain it all, right? So you get these little verses here and there, and it just reminds you of something, and then that connects, that connects a few of the pieces that you, just one verse from time to time. So it's good, right? So I've been talking about the war of the mind, and I wanted to talk more from Hebrews 13, but given I'm around about 2 hours now, I want to try and keep this. I want to try and keep them under 2 hours, but I want to try and keep this under 2.5, around about 2.5. So I'm just going to just touch on it and then talk about just the surgery and a story that happened, just a testimony I had after that. This is a big scripture now, always has been, entertaining the angels, right? Remember them that are in bonds as abound with them, and we suffer adversity as you yourselves also in the body, right? The body of Christ. And we talk about marriage, but let your conversation be without covetousness, right? So without envy, and be content with such things as you have, for he said, I will never leave thee nor forsake her. The Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man can do unto me. This goes into the calendar. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Remember them that have your rule over you, right? So this for me, these are the Holy Spirits. These aren't the giants ruling the royal. These are the spirits that we read about in Romans 13. Who have spoken unto you the word of God, right? There we go there. That's it there. That for me could be pertaining to this when we entertain these angels. Because I know I've had these really strange interactions with strangers, and you just think, whoa, I think that may have been the Holy Spirit, right? Because they're delivering the word of God, the seed, the water, right? Whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. Jesus Christ the same today and forever. Now, don't be carried about with diverse and strange doctrines, right? Strange Jesuses being seduced by the harlot that leads you to worshipping a strange gospel, a strange Jesus, a strange God, right? Now, this is huge now. We have an altar. I'm going to pick up on this potentially next video as it pertains to the tabernacle of the congregation. As I ask this question, are we looking at the tabernacle of the congregation, the holy place is actually the inner workings of a man, and the most holy place is actually the Lord. And that curtain that separates the two is the veil. That's the veil. That's the flesh of the Lord Jesus Christ that was ripped away when he was crucified, wasn't it? And now we enter in through that veil, through the blood of Jesus, right? Wherefore also that he might sanctify. So that word sanctify also is just becoming absolutely epic. And I want to talk about that next video as well. Sanctify the people with his blood, right? With his blood. So purify the people with his own blood. Well, pick it up here. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. So it's just so fascinating because I see this now as the fruit of our lips. So this is due to the blood, the progression of faith. The fruit of our lips is actually a sacrifice to God. So it's very interesting. And also it goes to the calendar from today as well. Amazing. So it's actually a sacrifice because our whole life's become a sacrifice to God, doesn't it? So I say before, I've lost my whole old life, but I consider it done, that I may win Christ, right? But to do good and to communicate, forget not, for with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. So there it is there, right? So we can please God with the choices we make. Because if we make the choice to do well, to do good, and to communicate, that with those sacrifices, the fruit of our lips, God's well pleased. Well done, my good and faithful servant, because you've gone and used these talents, that grace that I've given you, Now I'm going to give you more talents because you've come back and you've been profitable and you've brought back more talents. You're bringing back your stores are full. Your stores are full of fruit, right? And then we get it again in verse 17. Obey them that have rule over you. So these are the hiring of his garden souls and men again. These are the Holy Spirit. And submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls as they that must give account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you, right? The higher end is guarding the souls of men. Pray for us, for we trust we have a good conscience. It's everything in all things, willing to live honestly. Right? Our conscience becomes everything. But I beseech you the rather to do this, and this goes to my testimony I'm about to share, conscience and honesty. But I believe you the rather to do this, that I may be restored to you the sooner. That's language like that just reminds me of Paul. It makes me think that Hebrews was written by Paul. Now the God of peace, so Jerusalem, teaching of peace, set you at double peace, peace be unto you. And that's the mother of us all, Jerusalem. And wisdom is justified of her children. Now the God of peace, so the Lord's wisdom, that bring again, so the God that hit the peace, the teaching of that peace is Jerusalem, God's wisdom, the mother of us all. That brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep through the blood, right? Of the everlasting covenant, the blood, right? The purification of the blood that will make you perfect into every good work to do his will, willing in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. So this thing, like, I would love for that guy on BitChute, not the one I just shared, but the one from a couple of videos ago, I'd love it if he could watch a couple of my videos, you know? Not because I'm anyone major, but just for me, if he wanted the truth, it doesn't mean he has to watch my videos, but if he wanted the truth and he watched my videos, you can see that he's just in such error, and I can't stop thinking about this bloke. Like, my heart is just really bleeding for him, you know? And it's in a good way. It's not, yeah, you're going to hell, and you've been seduced and all that. And it's just like, you feel like shaking him. Because you see he's got an appetite for God. Or does he? Or does he? Because it's like, I don't know. If you actually want the truth, you'll get it, won't you? So, no. Anyway, make you perfect in every good work. Make you perfect, and we have a good conscience to live honestly. So I was talking about the war of the mind, right? So I had the big operation. It's now about 48 hours since I had it. It's now Friday afternoon. I had it about midday on Wednesday. And it went perfectly. All the staff were wonderful, from the lady behind the counter to the nurse to the doctor. The doctor was weird, but he was a really nice guy, right? But it all went absolutely perfect. And it was a taxing experience because I had something on my body that shouldn't have been there. But it was nothing, but it was something. It's nothing to be alarmed about, but it's something that had to go, right? And I'll just say it was on a quite a sensitive part of my body, right? I'll leave it just there. And it was emotionally, it was almost traumatizing. The lead up to it, the actual procedure was okay in the end, but it was a very taxing experience, And I was quite tired by the end of it. And what I did, I thought, no, I'm going to go down to the shops. I'm going to go and have a cuppa just to have a bit of a celebration here because I'm feeling good. And I thought, let's go and debrief with myself. And I went and read a couple of pages of Hebrews, and it was good. But I found I got myself, I started to feel really, really tired. And I went to Kmart and I actually got my cupboard. I bought it. It was there on Friday. I bought it. And I just had this surgery and I got the stitches in. I'm carrying this thing back to my car. I'm thinking, oh, Brett, you've got to be mad, mate. What are you doing all this for? But it's all good. It's healing perfectly. I'm really, really happy with it. Anyway, I'm coming out of there and there's this lady on the door and I'm struggling with this thing. It's quite heavy, you know. It would have weighed about probably 20 or so kilos, which is, you know, it's not overly heavy, but it's just really awkward, you know. And she says to me, do you mind if I have a look at the receipt? And I'm thinking, you've got to be joking. You know, I've got to put this thing down. I've got to go in and get it out of my wallet. I just didn't expect it, you know. It's like Kmart's so ridiculous. They used to have the checkouts right up the front. You buy your thing, you're out of the shop and you walk away. But now they put their checkouts all the way down in the shop. And when you walk out, you've got to demonstrate a receipt because they think you're stealing something. And it's like, well, you move the checkouts there. And everything was fine the way it was, but they have to move the checkouts into the middle of the shop. And then I can't stand it. It really annoys me. It's like you buy something at a shop and then you've got to prove you bought it because they just think you're stealing all the time. It does my head in, right? And I'm thinking, and I'm feeling quite short now. I'm like, I'm really tired and I'm just pretty well over people at this point that day. Because I'd had the operation and I was tired and just a little bit cranky, you know? And it's like everybody was walking on the right and I'm thinking, I've just got to get home here. I'm no good to anybody. I've just got to get home, right? And the lady, she said it and I'm thinking, oh. And people are walking out and she's not saying a word, you know? And I, old me, which was still stirring inside, this is the battle of the mind, right? He's still fighting away. He's still fighting away inside the old man, you know? And I thought, oh, and I didn't snap, but I thought of it. It was still there. It wasn't close to happening, but it was still there. It was in my mind to do it, you know? Anyway, I got the receipt and she just says, big brother's watching. I've got to do the right thing, right? And I'm thinking the whole time, you're just picking me out of the crowd, you know? You can see I'm struggling, But it turns out I went there today and I bought something today and he asked me for the receipt and they don't normally do it when you... I'd normally walk out of Kmart with a bag and they never ask for my bag, right? But it seems that's their policy. They ask for a receipt when you buy something. So she was legitimate, right? And I got it out. I got the receipt out and I looked at her and she's a pretty girl and she got a big smile on her face and she looked at me and she says, it's a lovely day out there today, isn't it? And I said, yeah, it is. I said, it's an absolutely beautiful day. She says, you enjoying the sunshine? I said, I am enjoying the sunshine. And she just gave me this beautiful, lovely smile, you know. And all of it just went away that was inside. All of that, just I was feeling tired and short. And I thought, there's something about that girl. I can't stop thinking about her. I was really hoping she'd be there today. There was something about that girl. There was something going on with her, that look on her face. And I thought, did I just entertain an angel? It was just remarkable. She was just that person I needed at that moment to snap me out of that mood, you know? Amazing. The war of the mind, right? The war of the mind. And I really feel as though the Holy Spirit helped me out of a bit of a bind that day. So who knows what would have happened when I, between there and getting back to the car. You don't know what sort of interactions you might have, you know? And Satan's always about... You let your guard down. Satan's always about, right? And I really feel as though I was saved there from myself. That was wonderful, right? The war of the mind. The purification of the blood. And that's what we get here in Hebrews. With a, living honestly with a good conscience through the blood, making you perfect in every good work, right? I didn't sin. I didn't do anything, you know? And it's good. I didn't react. And I just stayed patient. Just thinking about the Lord Jesus Christ, thinking about the gospel, bringing every thought into obedience, into the captivity of Christ. And that girl was amazing. I feel as though at the moment her smile's just imprinted in me. It's just amazing. What an interaction, right? So the Queen's dead. I'll finish up on a couple of testimonies here. The Queen's dead. So when you heard it, what did you think? What did you think? Now, when I first heard it, I thought, nothing, really. There was a time where I would have been delighted, but now I'm not, which I think is a good sign. I don't care. It's like, for me, it's whatever. I think I'm getting crooked here. For me now, it's like, whatever. It's all just part of the agenda, right? But what did you actually think when it happened? Is it okay for members of the body of Christ to go, good, you were evil? Is that all right? Is that being heartless? Is that loving your neighbor as yourself? Is that outside of the gospel? What would the Lord Jesus Christ have said? What would Paul have said? What would Peter have said if they were alive when the Queen died? I'm not being led to think there's any member of the body of Christ who are actually being purified by the blood, who have actually repented, are sad that the Queen died. But I think the key to it is not to manipulate how you think. It's just where your progression of faith is at for me. Well, I'm not going to judge anybody else and tell anybody else what to do and how to feel. But for me, I feel it's a real sign in my faith that I just take no pleasure from it at all. It's like, whatever, right? And I don't feel it means anything great. It's just it's obviously their agenda. It's a new stepping stone to what they're doing, but it's not. I don't see it's going to amp up anything really. I don't think myself, but I did see this morning. For the first time, I saw the term King Charles. And the first time I saw it, it's up on screen now, he's sitting on that gold throne, right? King Charles. And it's interesting because he's big on global change. And I think that could be the significance of them selecting this time for the Queen to die, right? Because for me, it's not organic. I'm far past that, as we all are, right? It's all part that, all of this is time. There's an enormous amount of people that are old, famous people here in Australia dying at the moment. It's just one after the other. It's quite incredible. But Charles is big on global change. And we know his father, his evil satanic father. I won't play the clips now because I'm getting too late in this video. I've gone too long already. But he was a eugenist because he connected the two. Population control and global change, right? Because we're not looking after the environment. The environment is suffering because there's too many of us, so there needs to be less of us, right? And it's population control in terms of numbers, but also in controlling us. Because they're going to be able to put, you have to have this thing on your phone, and you're only going to be able to use a certain amount, and you're going to have to, and if you go over, and you have to use electric cars, which they can control, and the whole thing is just a very, very slippery slope indeed into the pit of just this Orwellian nightmare, right? So global change is, for me, it's most certainly eugenics. And this ties in with me with the blood, right? Because I've been thinking about it. So Satan's a counterfeiter, and a parable is a heavenly, an earthly story, I knew I'd get it wrong, is an earthly story with a heavenly meaning, right? Now, you look back to the royal family in the 1930s in Germany, what were they doing? They were setting up the thousand, yes, the thousand year, it's a familiar number, right? The thousand year Reich, the rule of the great Aryan white race, the purified white race, right? Now, we've been purified by the blood of Christ, and that's going to end up with us purifying, and we're going to be wearing the white robes, right? Because the white linen is the linen, it's the raiment of the saints in Revelation 19. When we're purified, when we get to the outcome of the progression of faith, that blood of Christ, it's going to wash us clean, and we're going to be pure and white, and that pure white race, the body of Christ, for the want of it, it's not a race, we're just the saved, right? But we're going to be pure white, purified by the blood of Christ, right, in the thousand year reign. And that's exactly what they were doing in the 1930s, weren't they? And they were eugenists. And you look at Charles, he's big on global change, so he, for me, is a eugenist as well. And he's as white as they come. They're all German. They all come from German. They're all, even the members of the royal family, they're all members of the royal family, right? So I thought, this is too, it's just, right, I'm learning about this, the blood, this vile creature, the queen dies, and it's all connected, right? The white, and that, like, because that's what they are, they're all white supremacists, these creatures running the world. And it's just so interesting now because I look out here in Australia right now, and the most disadvantaged people here in Australia right now, when you just look at the media, are middle-aged, single, even married, white, heterosexual men that are healthy. They're the most disadvantaged here. Like, it's not equal unless the Aboriginals in Australia are being advantaged, and it's not equal for women unless women are being advantaged. So we have to have quotas for women getting jobs. We have to have equal pay for women's sports, even though it's an inferior product, because if a woman plays a man, the woman won't win. not in a month of Sundays. So it's an inferior product, so they shouldn't be on more money, but whatever, right? And I've never seen a woman disadvantaged in a workplace financially because she's a woman ever. And I actually asked around at Telstra, like in the last couple of years there. But it's not like you can have women-only gyms and it's fine. But if you have a man's only gym, no way. That's sexist, right? And if you have men-only quotas, well, then that's completely sexist, and it's completely, which it is. If you have to be a man to do this job, unless it's a man's job, right? But if it's just out and out prejudice that you just don't like women, so you have to have a man in that job, of course that's sexist, and it's no different. If it doesn't pass the test this way, it doesn't pass the test that way, right? But that's what they're doing right over the earth right now, is that anybody who disagrees with a narrative, it's like, if you're black, you're perfect. I can see that in America, and it's the same here in Australia. You look at everything, like you don't want to be criticized. You just want no criticism from the media here in Australia. You just put a black person there, or you put a woman there, and they won't get criticized. But you put a bloke there, a white heterosexual middle-aged male, and look out. It's just open slather, right? So it's just so interesting. I start to wonder now if it's one big massive deflection, because that's what they are. They're all white supremacists. They're all members of the royal family. They're all eugenists. And that's why they're pushing this global change, because that's what it is. It's population reduction and population control on all levels. As I learn about the blood, the purification into white raiment, and that's exactly what they were doing in the 1930s Germany as they were setting up the Thousand-Year Reich, right? It's amazing. It all connects. It all connects. So this bloke, right? So remember that football jersey, the Manly football jersey? I saw this photo today come up on my screen, and this is during that speech where he was just throwing out these Masonic hand signs, which just made it as plain as day that that's what all of this was about. I might just turn my light on. But that's what all of this was about. It was all just Masonic theatre. This pride jersey thing, it was just a divide. You're either with those people who took the stand, which mean you're against the LBG alphabet soup mob, the rainbow crowd, or you're with the rainbow crowd, which means you're against them, which means you're against religion, because that's what they did it on, that's what they based on, their religious beliefs. But nobody wants to listen to me when I say that there's just no conflict. The Holy Spirit will not reject you because you've been born gay. He just won't, right? He just won't. And I see it with this transgender thing. I share this page in a minute with this girl. Just unbelievable. It's had such an impact on me. But it was all Masonic theatre. And this transgender, it's very, very real. It's real. But the way they're using transgender now, it is sick. Oh, these people are just next level sick. But you look at this, and that looks like a very unhappy man, doesn't it? Like, you look at that, and the wicked men are the wicked walk on every side when the vilest men are exalted, right? Now, this is vile. This is an absolutely vile, putrid person, and I'm very, very comfortable and confident. I'm not condemning myself by judging. He's judging himself. The queen judges herself by her works. This is a vile, vile excuse for a man. Pushing that agenda as he just throws out these Masonic hand signs, and he looks absolutely miserable. And I just think of the year I've had, the last week I've had in my walk, and there's just no chance you could ever have me looking like that at the moment. No chance whatsoever. It's just amazing, right? They can have their Freemasonry. Is it Psalm 37? Don't fret because of the wicked. Don't be envious of the wicked because they're exalted and they're getting all of these riches. You look at, this is a face. This is a face of just pure misery. And how does it make you feel? I look at it and I think, well, it's justice. But I take no satisfaction with it. It doesn't bring me any joy. It just makes me sad. It just makes me sad. And the choice is there for this man to repent, but nah. I don't know what drives these Masons. They must know. Anyway, they just seem to do it to their death. Don't know, right? Don't know. Here she is. So her name's Jalissa Vine. Now, from what I see, she seems legitimate. She seems legitimate to me. So I just stumbled upon it today, and I watched that one there, the aftermath of my transition. So this is a girl who, when she was a teenager, about 16, she got conned. Watching that video there, this was a girl who got conned into this transgender business. And it's funny because she says that she used to, a lot of these old videos, you can see she's still a man by the looks. She's still a, like a transgender man. But then the videos seem to make a change, opening up about my detransition, right? So she regrets it. And this girl, she's gone the whole hog. I saw a video this morning. It's so raw, man. I just thoroughly recommend you watch this girl. It's so raw. It's so real by the looks of it to me. I'm not smelling a rat at all. And this is the aftermath of it. And that's what these creatures are doing now. She said she had upstairs surgery and downstairs surgery. And she said, it's heartbreaking. It's absolutely heartbreaking, but it's real. And that's what these creatures are doing. And the week I had this surgery, and that surgeon was so good to me. And we've got monsters out there who are just absolutely destroying these people's lives. And just absolutely, just what they're doing to these people. Just, I can't think of the word. I'm just mutilating them. That's the word. Surgeons. Surgeons are mutilating 16-year-old girls, like taking out their womanhood. She can never have chance. She's just heartbroken. And her whole life is shattered, this girl. So I thoroughly recommend that you give this girl a view. It's heartbreaking. And I've actually subscribed to her. And I'm going to probably watch all the videos because it's real, right? It's real and it's raw, and it really, this is the impact of what those creatures are doing. And this is the thing. This is what they want. They want to destroy people's lives, and they want them miserable down the line. And just, I come out to my five-year-old students, and some of them have decided they're transgender as well. And that's just sick, man. We live in very, very sick times. So this one, little calendar, right? So I'll finish with a couple of calendars. So the little one yesterday, this is, I say, a timely reminder, Proverbs 9:10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. So I see the fear of the Lord, as I've been putting down, that's belief in the Lord Jesus Christ. So you can't have that fear of the Lord unless you repent. So that fear of the Lord, that's the beginning of wisdom. The blood, right? Where we receive the blood. And the knowledge of the holy is understanding. So I see that word holy now, and it becomes very, very interesting as it pertains to the purification and the sanctification and the separation, because that's what holy is. Holy is set apart. And I know it's in the New Testament, that word holy for Holy Spirit and Holy Ghost, it's the same Greek word as saints, right? It's separated and it's set apart. So the knowledge of the holy, the separated, the consecrated, the separate, is understanding. The blood, right? I see the blood. I absolutely see the blood in this. And then the big one today, right? For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. We are his workmanship, right? So we are God's husbandry. We are his building. We are his workmanship, right? Created in Christ Jesus unto good works by the blood, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. And that's the thing with that guy on pit shoot. I just keep thinking about him, right? It's just, he's not getting the point. He's just not getting the point. Now the real work begins. Now your life comes alive. Now you've actually got a purpose. Here we go, right? It's now time for the main event. It's time to get to work. Let's go. You got the job? Now it's time to get to work. And then today, Romans 12:1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, so set apart, sanctified, consecrated, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. So our bodies now become a living sacrifice upon the altar of the Lord. The fruit of our lips, right? Our whole lives actually become a sacrifice unto God. Beautiful, right? Absolutely beautiful. As we get made perfect in every good work through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's most certainly, so just looking at the run sheet here, that's most certainly, I want to talk about that next video, but again, I haven't really got to a lot of what I wanted to talk about today because a few things happened, a few testimonies came in, and sharing Philippians 2 to the degree I did, that sort of changed the video as well. But I certainly want to talk about, I've got the tabernacle, is the tabernacle the inner part of man and God, and that veil is actually the flesh of the Lord Jesus Christ, because I'm seeing, I'm just going on memory, what is there? The shewbread. The shewbread pertains to somebody's purpose in the New Testament. The Greek word for shewbread, it's purpose. Shewbread and purpose is the same Greek word. Now we've got the table, which connects to the tables of the heart. And then we've got the candle, which connects to the spirit of man, which the God uses to search the inward parts of the belly, right? Now in the holy place, that's where all those things were. Now I'm not totally sure where the altar was. I seem to think it may have been outside the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. I don't know if it was in the holy place or whether it was outside the door. I'm not sure. I'll pop it up on screen if I can find it. And I'll certainly look out for that when I read the scriptures again. But that's what I see. And then we've got the table, the candle, and the shewbread in the holy place. So I'm being led to think that's the innermost parts of the man. Now, in the most holy place, we've got the mercy seat, and then we've got the two cherubims, and that's where God dwells, upon the mercy seat, above the mercy seat, between those two cherubims. And then we've got the Ark of the Covenant, which I've been testing for a while, could very well be the heart of God, which I'm still being led to think it was the heart of God. And in that heart was tables, right? The tables of the heart, tables of stone, because that's the heart of stone, right? Remember that song by Cher, the heart of stone. And that was the ministration of condemnation and death in the Old Testament. And it all connects back to, it's Corinthians, 1st, 2nd Corinthians, the condemnation, it might be 9, the ministration of death, the ministration of condemnation and death. It all pertains to that, and also the sprinkling of the vessels of the blood. And I can't wait to start this Old Testament now, because it's like the life of the man is in the blood, and I seem to remember that it's the blood that actually the blood atones the sin, the blood in the Old Testament, and it's actually that blood that cleanses the altar. And I'm seeing the altar is where we lay our works before God. So back in the Old Testament, that altar was always dirty because of sin, and it always had to be purified year in, year out. There was always that remembrance for sin. So I certainly want to talk about that as well. But right now, I'm up to about 2 hours 40, so I've gone too long. And I will just say, anybody who's gotten anything out of this video, it's been very, very different. It's been a very different video indeed, this one. It's felt different, and I've had a lot going on during it, but it's been an absolute joy to put down, as they all are. And if anybody got anything out of it, that just means the absolute world to me. I thank you ever so much. We live in profound times. We live in very, very strange times, but I feel right now every day, I'm just coming into the most unbelievably exciting, which I never could have even thought possible, truths now. This revelation about the blood and what I'm seeing potentially about the tabernacle, and I haven't got to the cross yet, the Lord Jesus Christ, how he's not, for me, he's not calling for unrepentant sinners to be forgiven of the Father, not by a long shot. It is so, so exciting, and every day I read these scriptures, I thought my head was going to blow off yesterday when I read 1 Peter 1. I was saying to Mum when I saw her, I said, I don't think it's ever taken me so long to read a chapter of scripture than what it took me to read 1 Peter 1. It was just absolutely incredible. I think it's 1 Peter 1:2. Just that word is sanctify by the blood of Jesus, and it means purified. And it just hit me like a ton of bricks. It was coming in James, and then it just hit me like a ton of bricks. That's what this is. It's like this big blood transfusion. And that old blood is like the blood of sin and death that was running through us. And that's the Galatians 5 purge. And the more testimony we have, due to the more faith we have, that gives us more testimony. And that testimony gives us more faith, which gives us more blood. And the further we go, the further we go, the further we go, the more we've got the Lord Jesus Christ's blood coursing through our veins. And we just become whiter and whiter and whiter. Thus, we're going to burn brighter and brighter and brighter unto the perfect day. Oh, yes. What a wonderful way to finish this video, and what a wonderful time to be alive, a wonderful, glorious time to be in the body of Christ, and to He goes all the power and all the glory, the Lord Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Woo! Ha ha! The King!
Heaven and earth will disappear, but my words remain forever. But no one knows the date now when the end will be, not even the angels, no, nor even God's Son. Only the Father knows. The world will be at ease, banquets and parties and weddings, just as it was in Noah's time before the sudden coming of the flood. People wouldn't believe what was going to happen until the flood actually arrived and took them all away. So shall my coming be. Two men will be working together in the fields, and one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be going about their household tasks, one will be taken, the other left. So be prepared, for you don't know what day your Lord is coming.
Life was filled with guns and war, and everyone got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. Children died, the days grew cold, a piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind, the sun has come, you've been left behind. Time to change your mind, the sun has come.